When a set of timber fell off a ship, because a lot of timber came into Surrey Docks, which was the main Baltic port, and so you had Russian ships and Norwegian ships. And a set of timber fell into the barge, but the dockers actually were jumped into the river. They actually narrowly missed being killed by taking that action, swift action. They saw it coming over the side, straight over the side.
But is that...
That was dangerous. I think the local hospital had one ward, usually full of injured dockers, usually. So it was...
Is that actually on Greenland Dock? Is that
Greenland Dock, yes. It was always the timber dock. Then there was South Dock, which was just general cargo.
Yes.
I think the interesting thing about the docks was the fact that there was a division between the young and the old, as far as the young were far more adventurous. The generation gap was very, very strong in the docks. My friends there, one of them was a jazz pianist who played in clubs. Another one was a photographer, up to professional standard, and I still got it. They're the best photographs I ever had taken, and he was a docker. So they had all these skills, but I think because they were earning good money, they felt they'd stay where they were rather than just. But when they retired, I was glad to hear the photographer's song, so the business art, which was very gratifying for me. But I was saying, as I say, the younger generation were very open minded. And when I grew a beard in 1955, I think it was, I grew a beard, which was unheard of in the docks. In some docks. And I think I must have been quite perverse for a time. Anyway, there were batteries in the background. But the young doctors were very supportive, extremely supportive. I always made friends with the strongest and toughest. But eventually, of course, another docker grew up there. And so it sort of broke the mould in a way. Things began to loosen up a bit by 1960. There wasn't quite so hard attitudes. But I think that the dockers, I think, were a very special group. And I've got great affection for my years I spent in Surrey Docks. It was quite an eye-opener. It was a sight more interesting than being in the publicity office. Something more interesting.
Could I just tell you that Queen Hive,
yes.
Anyway,
yes.
I was there 3 days ago.
Yeah.
Because I was walking from London Bridge to St Paul's the embankment, the north side, and it's still there, but you don't get the vista through to St Paul's because on Lower Thames Street, on the far side, the north side of Lower Thames Street, there are new buildings which obscure the view to the dome. But the actual alleyway is still there.
So that's its historic then? So
yes.
Historic.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Hello. Yes, please.
Hi. Did you have a history with the Portuguese Authority staff art exhibition?
No.
I found posters and newspaper articles about various Port London staff and dockers that exhibited in Portland.
I suppose you don't know the date of it, do you? Was it? It might have been later, you see.
It's at this time, yeah.
Was it? When I was there, there was nothing like that in the 50s, as far as I know.
If this was at the tell our Hamlet's archive, so it might be not in
a bit later, yes. Yeah, probably, yes. Yeah. No, I think that this thing started to get far more livelier into the 60s, you know. But by that time, of course, I'd left. When I was there, it was quite sort of hard graft, really. I mean, there was no fun at all.
What questions at all?
How did you manage to go to art school at 13? How did you manage to get to go to art school when you were so young?
Yes, good question.
Was it an evening class?
No, good question. I don't know if it was the Labour government in the post-war period or whether it happened before, but there was a scheme whereby pupils who were obviously not going to do office material would have the opportunity to go to colleges and learn other skills. Silversmithing, ceramics, that sort of thing. Now, this was in 1945, 46.
And you went and the whole of the school there?
Well, yes. Well, what happened was the LCC, which it was then, London, issued a number of papers to all the schools, which were then sent round to the parents, saying, would you like your son to join a course at a college? We're offering this, that, and this, that, and the other, you know. And this was a marvellous thing, because it gave those pupils a chance to specialise in something of great depth. Yeah. So quite a few. Now, at 13, we couldn't join a specialist course. We had to do what was known as juniors. Mm-hmm. The juniors was all us youngsters going through a sort of introductory period where we had drawing from costume models. Drawing was quite strong. Yeah. We had a craft subject, which could be pottery, ceramics. And we also had one afternoon of painting. Now that went on all through the juniors, and at the age of 16 you then had to choose whether you specialised in a course for the diploma, as it was then, or you simply left and found employment in a, maybe in an office somewhere or a commercial art studio or something. Yeah. Quite a few people, I'd say about 80% left when they were 16, which was a great pity, really. Mm. And 20% who went on to do courses like myself. As I say, we had these wonderful teachers who were only too pleased to give us their knowledge. The grateful ears and the distinct victim parts who couldn't teach properly.
I want to ask what John Minton was like. What was John Minton like?
John Minton. He was a wonderful man. He was quite wonderful. First of all, he was very generous. He would give students food who he knew were poor. He would bring in fruit and distribute it. For some odd reason, he gave me a jersey, although I really needed it. But I was very pleased. I didn't wear it for quite a few years afterwards. But he was incredibly funny, witty. And also, his appearance was so strange. I mean, even before he uttered a word, you would have thought this is a very extraordinary man. His very long face, like an El Greco painting, very, very long, and very long tapering limbs. And he twitched when he spoke, or twitched a lot. His whole body was twitching. He's quite a remarkable person. But his career was very sad. I don't know if you know what happened to him. He put a painting into the Royal Academy, which was called The Death of Nelson. And I think friends were very doubtful about this. I think they felt that he shouldn't have done it because he had a reputation which was way above the RA's reputations. But for some odd reason he did this, and it wasn't one of his best paintings either. And it got a lot of flack from the critics. They didn't like it. And I can understand why. And I think he was affected by this. He was a very sensitive person. And I think it really somehow gave him a crisis of confidence. And he started drinking heavily. He'd always drunk quite a lot. But in the early days, he'd gone to jazz clubs, dancing with Susan Knight, who was another teacher at Canberra. And they'd jived at Parkland's jazz clubs. And that was when drinking was in control. But as time went on, it got out of control. And we don't know to this day whether he actually intended to commit suicide or whether it was an accident, because the bottles of pills that were found by the side of him and the drink, the two together finished him off. And we don't know whether it was intentional or accidental or what, but really it came to the end in a way of his creative life. I think the drink destroyed him completely. It's a terribly sad ending to a brilliant young career as a painter. Had he gone on for another 10 years, you know, it would have been wonderful, absolutely marvellous. And there you are. But his partner, Keith Gordon, who was his partner, was exactly the opposite. He was a more stable person. And he was very cautious, and he carried on painting. And of course, he's a big star now. Well, he's dead, but his paintings, you know, are sort of millions that he fought on.
Can you tell us a bit about Susan Einsig?
Susan Einsig? Well, Susan Einsig was a tutor at Canberwell who taught illustration. And she actually left Germany on the last boat before Hitler took over. She just got out with a skin of her teeth, saved her life. Her parents were on the boat. Her parents were assassinated by Hitler later. But she became a tutor at Canberra teaching illustration, and she was highly influential with the younger generation. And it's probably true to say we were great friends from the very first moment. It was more than a teacher-student relationship. We went to odd places together, and she bought me books on art, which I couldn't afford at that time. And she became Johnny Minton's partner. She became his sort of inseparable partner for quite a few years. They would go to jazz clubs together and dance in a fanatical way, which was, you've got to see it to believe it. And giant as well, the top half of it. But she then, after teaching Canberwell and becoming very popular, she then went to become head of illustration at Chelsea School of Art. And she remained there, I think, for about 20 years until she retired. And she died about 10 years ago. But I kept in touch with her for all that time. And personally, I do owe her a great deal, because she helped me enormously at a point when I really did need the help, and she was there. And I know that at Chelsea, many of the Chelsea pupils look back very fondly at her time there. Yeah. Any other questions at all?
I just wonder if you could tell us what happened to the painting, The Night Watchman.
Oh dear. Yes. Yes. this is, of course, a print of the original painting, which was painted mainly in three colours, yellow ochre, green and sort of creamy pale hue. It went to an exhibition in a gallery called the Sweetwaters Gallery in Crawford Street, about 1960, I think it was, and together with some other works of mine. And in the night, some thieves threw a car battery through the window of the gallery and stole the first row of paintings. The dealer put a very high price on my painting. He put 3,000 on it, which was absurd, you know, absolutely ridiculous. But anyway, he put this price on, and obviously the thieves thought that, there's something quite valuable. But anyway, they cleared out the front counter of all the paintings, and the glass smashed and damaged quite a few paintings behind. So I never saw that painting again. The police, who were too busy doing other things, weren't terribly interested in. In fact, I think it would have been quite impossible for them to find it. They did say, I made numerous inquiries afterwards to the police, and they did say that it had been spotted over the East End. Someone had seen it over the East End. But what happened to it, I don't know. So, you know, it's just got into the sort of...
Did you get your £2,000 insurance?
I did get insurance, but not £2,000. The gallery got most of it. Because
it would have been rather,
the other paintings.
It would have been rather a good sale.
Yeah. Well, they made a mess of the gallery. It was a terrible mess.
Horrible.
But, yes. So somewhere, I also had some paintings stolen from my motor car, which was heartbreaking. It was one of my best paintings, I think. And I thought of putting on my CV the underworld's favourite painter. Any more questions at all?
Well done.
This is a park which is quite near me. I never use it, it's my local. In the old days, it had a piano, of course, and people who got up and sang quite spontaneously. And it was lovely then, you could go there and relax, and there was no piped music. And a friend from Munich came over, a very educated German lady friend, stayed with us. And I took her to the pub one evening, and this lady got onto the microphone and said, "On half a Kearney's door, in the most horrendous voice." And the German friend sat there in utter astonishment. She couldn't believe it. Such a thing could happen. He said, "But she can't sing to me." That's the whole point. Come on, the microphone. "But can't sing."
Very funny.
I think it probably confirmed what the show saw about the effects of music. I think I spoke about these. This chap was injured. I think he was injured in an accident, a bad accident. I think some timber fell on him and he hurt his arm. When I look at some of these people, I realise how close they were to danger. This is a portrait of my father, which is a monotype, which I don't often do. Monotype is where you press paper, you draw an ink on the slab. Glass, you take one print. You can only really take one print. But that, I've been told by another visitor that it's very handsome, which I'm pleased to, sure you would have been pleased to hear it too. I think I'll probably end my talk now. If there's any other questions.